Hey guys, so in this video I want to talk about kind of what it takes, some of the unique challenges of becoming a social worker. And by unique, I think I feel like this social work is the only profession that requires this out of potential social workers. Requires is the key word here. So to become a social worker, you of course need to have a degree in social work. And I'm not sure about bachelor's. My bachelor's did. My bachelor's degree in social work did require me to be in an internship. Or be in field placement is the term in social work schools, to be placed in a field, placed in the field placement. But that's mandatory for social work education. I'm not sure for bachelor's, not quite sure. But for certain master's, yes, internship is mandatory. Let me repeat that. Internship in a social service setting is mandatory in if you want to pursue a social work degree, master's degree in social work. So that's the thing. But there are further details to that. So not only is internship mandated, what kind of internship it is also matters. It has to be with under in this internship, you have to be under a supervisor who is this terminology called CFE certified. So what CFE certified means, this supervisor is a licensed master's social worker. So this social worker has a master's in social work degree and is also licensed in it. And also it also means that this person has received social work supervisor training, which is CFE. So the CFE training qualifies them to be a supervisor. So in the internship that you're placed in, this person has to exist, and you have to be working under this person, and on a weekly basis. It doesn't just have to be like, oh yeah, this person works in this agency, and the supervisor is there, so I'm in the internship. That's that. No. On a weekly basis, you have to work under this supervisor. What that means is this supervisor checks up on you on every week. It depends on the school, but NYU requires at least 90 minutes of supervision with the supervisor every week. That's a requirement for this internship. That's a requirement to have a social work degree. So I think this is very unique in the field, and then in the profession. Psychology, I don't think requires, if you want to graduate with a master's in degree in psychology, I don't think it requires an internship. I'm also not sure about counseling. I kind of, this is a really crude way of thinking it, and it's not an accurate way of thinking it, but it's kind of like a residency. Doctors, after they, in order to kind of become a doctor, they have to undergo a residency. The first year is considered internship. Kind of like that. Not as intense. Of course, the comparison is faulty because it's not as intense. And also, the comparison is faulty because social work students don't get paid for their internship. I think this is a huge problem in this profession. So I just don't like the concept of unpaid internship in general. But the fact that you're required to have an internship 21 hours a week, and there has to be a certain kind of internship. So it's required, and it's unpaid. I think that's kind of the interesting thing about becoming a social worker. The process of becoming a social worker requires that you do 21 hours a week of unpaid internship. And it's demanding work. Like what I want to say right now, I have my internship at a high school. So I work under and with school social workers at a local high school. And I have a part-time job as a classroom tutor in a local elementary school. And as a classroom tutor, I make $14 an hour. And I usually work when I 2 days a week, and I work when I work that day, I'm there the whole school day. I'm there from morning to the last, an hour after the last class ended. So, that's my part-time job. My part-time job, like I'm being paid for it, but I'm having so much fun. I work with kindergartners, pre-K, third graders, fourth graders, fifth graders. All I do really is just talk to them and kind of show them how to do things. That's really all I do. I'm paid for it. Like, it's not hard for me. I have a ton of fun with it. I make lesson plan with the teacher. Like, it's... It doesn't feel like work to me. It's easy, and I get paid for it. That's the thing. My social work internship, I enjoy it. This is my field. I have passion for it. But it's demanding work. Therapy with students, planning group therapy, you know, getting these 11 or 15 students together in one room and having group therapy together, having supervision session with supervisor, with my supervisor, planning all this and outreaching to parents with attendance issues, and it's a lot of work. It's really demanding. It's so, by the time I come home, I feel so drained. I'm like, oh my gosh, I've done so much today. Feel like that. You know, and there's documentation. I have to do a lot of paperwork. It's actual work. Like, my internship feels so much more like actual work than my paid job. But my internship, I do not get paid for it. So I think that's an interesting thing. And I understand why, you know, social work internships, almost all of them are done in non-profit agencies. Except when you kind of... There are certain cases when your internship is going to be at a for-profit agency. You know, a colleague of mine is working in an intern, it has an internship or field placement in a hospital. It's a for-profit hospital. So certainly there are situations where social workers will end up in for-profit settings. And there are such things as corporate social workers as well. Although I'm not sure if those kind of settings accept internships, accept interns. I don't know, but it would be, I would feel like in those settings, at least hoping that like the social work intern gets paid to do it. But yeah, I understand why that is. It is a training learning experience, but at the same time, we are doing our job. It's a very demanding thing. But anyway, that's one of the unique things about social work profession. The whole controversy about, well, it's not really controversy, but the idea of it being unpaid versus being paid is probably a different can of worms altogether that I'm not going to talk any more about. But you know my position on that. Like, it really sucks. What really sucks is, you know, we have, I'm a lot of my colleagues, you know, we got to pay rent. So they're doing part-time jobs, or they have jobs. They're in the extended year program, which means they didn't start their internship. They don't start their internships on their first year of school, but they will have to because, like I said, internship is mandatory to get a degree in social work. It's mandatory. So in their second year, they're going to have to work 21 hours a week without getting paid for it, right? A lot of them currently have full-time jobs, you know, and they're paid for their jobs. But next year, they're going to have to start thinking, like, how to do that, how to pay rent and all that, while still working 21 hours a week without being paid for it. So I think that's one of the biggest challenges becoming a social worker. Not only because internship is mandatory, but also because you're not paid for it. This is another thing. Another thing that's unique to this profession is called process reporting. And if any of you social work students or any social workers are watching this, like, that's a dreadful term for a lot of us. So it's process reporting. It's pretty much any client interaction that we have that we think were valuable learning experiences. We record it. But how do we record it? Verbatim. So we sort of become, without a recording device, because oftentimes, I mean, in certain situations, I think we can ask permission from the clients to record the conversation, and we can use a recording to do a process recording of, but in most cases, because of the ethical issues surrounding that, yeah, most cases, you're going to be using this. You know, we're going to be using this. We're going to be trying to, like, oh my gosh, that session, what did that person say? And try to write down exactly what that person said. How did I respond? And try to write down exactly what I said during that session. And then you have three columns usually. There are different kinds of process recording. There's a narrative process recording. There's a verbatim process recording. But the concept is the same. You write down what happened, what was said in that session, in that client interaction. You want to write down word for word what happened. And then you have this column, you know, which is about, like, your observations, your thoughts, your responses, your feedback. And analysis, you know, like, maybe you said this, but now, you know, after it's been said, now you're processing the recording of it. And you're like, I said this, this because I felt this way about what the client said here, and this is how I responded. In hindsight, after reading, you know, this certain book by this social worker, it's clear to me that this is an example of my countertransference. I probably would have done better to respond in this manner instead. That kind of analysis. And then there's this column for supervisory feedback, because you have your 90 minutes of supervision. And so when you meet with your supervisor is going to discuss the process recording with you and give her feedback, or his feedback. It's usually her, because social work is a pretty female-dominated field. But yeah, that's process recording in a nutshell. Most colleges, most universities require a social work students to do 3 process recordings a week. But that's a pretty flexible number. Currently, my social work supervisor, is like, I can only handle 2 a week. So 2 a week is fine. And I informed my field instructor, my practice professor, you know, that's fine as long as it's agreed upon, as long as the school is aware of it. But yeah, those are the 2 unique challenges of the profession. So, like, I give a lot of props to people who have master's degree in social work, because it's just like, yeah, you went through that. You know, you went through, you know, 2,000 hours of, not 2,000, sorry. It's like 21 hours, 2 years, ballpark estimate, about 1,800 hours of, actually, no, that's way too over. It's like, I don't know, somewhere around 1,200. You went through 1,200 hours of unpaid internship, and every week of that internship, you did at least 2 or 3 process recordings a week. So, yeah, considering that, like, I think, you know, social work training, you know, for people who don't know it, like, dismiss it, you know, a lot of days. It's like, you want to work in the nonprofit sector, you want to work helping people, like, you don't need a degree for that, you know. You want to be a social worker, be, you know, get rich, use money, be a social worker, help people, you know, using your wealth. There's that kind of response. Clearly, they do not understand what it takes to be a social worker. Clearly, they do not know. But wealth will help. If I did have money, if people did have money, becoming a social worker, you know, not being paid for their passion, for their internship, would be an okay thing, but people do have to pay rent, so that's the problem with that. But yeah, that's kind of what I wanted to just kind of talk about, like what it takes to be a social worker. Now, process recording, you know, it's in some ways it's a dreadful term because it's so time consuming, it takes so much effort. But I do realize it's a pretty valuable tool for potential social workers or future social workers. It really does help us analyze what was said in each response, and in hindsight is really 20/20, and it helps us to become better professionals and better practitioners of social work. So I think it's really important. And I think it's a good thing that the field requires process recordings. You know, if anything, I think more fields should require process recordings because it's helpful. It sucks to do them, but it's helpful in the long run. But yeah, that's all I'll say about it. You know, I think I'll be right to assume that most of people who watch this video don't really know what social work education is like. So maybe this is like their first time hearing about what social workers have to go through to become social workers. But you know, for any of those who are watching who are social work students or who are social workers, yeah, you know, if you have anything to say, any comments, whatever about that, leave me a comment. Like, seriously, process recordings, God, you know? All right, well, take care, guys.